Hey, this is Byron Allen. Happy Juneteenth. And please check out the article that I wrote at TheGrio, Black America Speaks, America Should Listen, and What We Need to Do to Never Come Back Here Again. These are historic times, and we have a huge opportunity to finally address systemic racism in this country and make a change. So let's work together, everybody. Let's lean in and let's get it done. And remember, TheGrio will always be here for you. Happy Juneteenth.
Hey, Grio fam. My name is Natasha Alford, Vice President of Digital Content at TheGrio.com. And I want to say thank you for tuning into our Juneteenth live celebration. In times like these, it is more important than ever that we preserve Black joy, but also uplift the message that Black lives do matter. That's why we're so grateful that you are supporting us, Black-owned media. We're unfiltered, committed, and constantly dedicating ourselves to telling the stories that matter most in our community. So, what can you do to help us? Go ahead and hit that share button right below and make sure you spread the word about our Juneteenth live celebration. And beyond that, like our page, follow us on Twitter, follow us on Instagram. We only exist because your support is there for us. Happy Juneteenth Day. This is our moment, our stories, our way. Continue to fight for freedom.
Hi, Grio family. I'm Christina Greer. I'm an associate professor at Fordham University, the author of Black Ethnics, but more importantly, I'm the politics editor at The Grio. And tonight, I have my two fantastic co-host with me. I've got Mark Lamont Hill, who's a professor of media studies and urban education at Temple University, a Philly boy, and you should definitely check him out at Uncle Bobby's bookstore in Philly when you can, and especially online. And also the fabulous Dana Blair, Princess of Louisiana, I might community activist, brand ambassador, entrepreneur, and just an on-air personality. And I'm so honored and thankful to spend my Juneteenth with both of you today. Happy Juneteenth.
Guys. Happy Juneteenth.
Yes, happy Juneteenth. Thank you so much. I love that intro. Well,
I can be your new hype woman. So I just, you know, The Grio, it has been working diligently to put together a great program for us for the next hour and a half. But I just wanted us to chat really briefly about the importance of today in our lives. As we think about questions about Black emancipation, questions about can Black people ever be full citizens in this world, and why we should celebrate this Black resilience and the fact that Black history is American history and that all of us should know it and celebrate it. So Dana, I'll get some of your thoughts first.
Sure. I think we were talking about this a little bit before the program started. You know, Juneteenth has always been a part of my history. I grew up in the Deep South. I grew up in a small town in the Deep South called Alexandria, Louisiana. So there are different markers and signs throughout my city of where Confederate soldiers used to be as historic landmarks and Union soldiers and how my town was burned to the ground during the war. And so it's always been a part of my life and my history and my dialogue. My father picked cotton. These are things that have always been very present in my life and how we helped to build this country. We are the foundation, our blood, sweat, and tears for this country. So it's long overdue, in my opinion, for Juneteenth, as well as the contributions people of color have made to this country, that they're starting to finally be recognized in a more monumental way.
Mark, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with all of that. You know, I think about Juneteenth as, in many ways, a metaphor for the Black experience here. You know, one, on the 4th of July, which will come up in a couple of weeks, so many Americans will be celebrating their independence. And July 4th, 1776 just doesn't mean that to us. It couldn't mean that to us. We were enslaved. And so it's a marker of Juneteenth in many ways marks that difference of what it means to be Black in this country, to build this place for the American empire to be built on our backs with our labor, yeah, our unpaid labor. And yet we weren't citizens at the moment that America is birthed. And also when I think about the journey from 1863 to 1865, I'm forced to think about the delay of freedom. Even when it's written into law, things don't happen when they're supposed to happen or when they could happen. And so in many ways, that is the metaphor for what it means to be Black in America, that our justice is delayed constantly. Our freedom is delayed constantly. Our prosperity is delayed constantly. It's never fully denied because we won't let it be that. But it's not from a lack of people trying, you know? So this is a day of remembrance for me, but it's also a day of Black joy. Because when I think about that joy that people experienced in Galveston, when I think about the pleasure people had to know that a small slice of the freedom struggle had been completed, or big slice, honestly. I want to shed a tear, and I want to think about how much joy that was, and I want to carry that joy onto now.
Yeah, well, I think that so many of us are feeling grateful, even in the midst of so much turmoil that has existed in this nation and exists today. I mean, Black folks have been the original patriots who died first in so many of America's wars, but there is a way that we can celebrate joy. So Mark, kick us off with our first guest today.
Oh man, so we talk about joy, right? We got some good people here. TheGrio, I just gotta say this, for TheGrio done came up, you know what I'm saying? Y'all are doing great. We're doing great. I should say we. I'm part of the fam. We're doing great. We got some amazing people tonight. I'm not surprised, but I'm still excited to see that we have Senator Kamala Harris. We got Jemele Hill, my homegirl. We got the legendary Kelly Rowland all here tonight that have some words for us. But before we do that, let's get started with an African celebratory dance from the Muntu Dance Theater Company. They are so fresh. Check this out.
Hey everyone, so it's Juneteenth again, but this one, well, it feels a little different. It's always a day to remember the millions who suffered, died, and those who survived the crushing reality of America's system of enslavement. We rejoice in their strength and ultimate perseverance to achieve an end to slavery. But this year, as we enter a new era of reckoning and transformation, as we lay our collective hands on the arc of justice and feel the ground shift beneath our feet, on this Juneteenth, we honor their lives and historic sacrifice by looking to the future. This year, we celebrate the sacrifice of millions with the hard work of millions more. It will look different for everyone. Some are marching through the streets. Some are literally transforming their cities. I am working to pass our Justice and Policing Act. Together with Cory Booker, this is the first ever comprehensive police accountability bill. Some are delving deeper into systems of power to infuse visions for change. And some are looking inward, personally, or within their organizations, to root out complex harbors for privilege, racism, or injustice. Today, our nation, built on the backs and the bodies of so many, including those slaves, is set to move forward again with the power and grace of our ancestors guiding us and their wisdom behind our eyes. We are locking arms and staring down America's systems of oppression. And though it's hard to imagine all the awful words shouted at them and whispered in their ears over lifetimes and generations, I pray we can hear them now, and they can hear us now, chanting a truth they were denied for centuries, that Black lives matter, that their lives mattered because they did and still do. Happy Juneteenth, everyone. celebrate, remember, and let's get to work.
I'm embarrassed to say that I didn't really know about Juneteenth until well into my adulthood. And even once I initially learned about it, I can't say that I put it on the same level as 4th of July, Memorial Day weekend, or even Labor Day. But through life experiences, as I've grown older, wiser, became more educated, I then began to understand the importance of Juneteenth and how, of all the holidays, this needs to be number one. More than any other year, I think this Juneteenth is gonna feel differently for a lot of us. When you think about all of the collective trauma that we faced in this year alone, the murders of Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and most recently, George Floyd, we need this holiday as a reminder that we have overcome and survived so much, and in a lot of ways, so much worse than anything than what we've experienced in 2020, as bad as it has been. When you think about what America is supposed to stand for, Black people are the ideal. We're the American dream because we gave selflessly to this country, our blood, our sweat, our tears. We poured everything in this country knowing that we were not recognized as an equal partner in this nation's foundation. We did it knowing that our humanity was either conditional or non-existent. We are the American ideal, and we need to be reminded that we're the standard of patriotism, despite whoever tries to hijack the narrative. Nobody has given as much to this country as we have as a people. And so we need to be recognized, not just for our contribution, but how we have continued to endlessly pour ourselves into a democracy that hasn't always stood for us. So on this Juneteenth, we need to be reminded, we need to take pride in the fact that we are the real America.
Growing up, I wasn't educated about Juneteenth. I mean, I never heard much about it, and I didn't understand what an important moment it represents or how crucial it is to celebrate our hard-won victories. Now that I'm grown, y'all know I got a family of my own, and it's so important for me to teach my son about our legacy, about our history, about our strength and perseverance through the greatest of trials. Our community has come so far, and yet there's still so much further to go. Right now, we are facing adversity from every angle, and COVID has us sick, unable to work, gather with our families, friends, congregations, and at the same time, we're fighting a system that seems to be set up against us. We're still fighting for freedom, still fighting for justice, still fighting for equality, and above anything, still fighting for our lives. That's why this year is so important, and I really hope everyone takes the time to educate themselves on the significance of this holiday. It remembers where we've been, so hopefully it can inspire us to get to where we're going. I hope we are reminded of our resilience and our unyielding quest for real freedom. We have to celebrate ourselves, and we have to celebrate each other. And we have to celebrate all of the beauty that comes from being Black so we can stand up against the ugliness inflicted on us for living in this skin, this glorious skin. We have to lift each other up today and every single day. So today I'm celebrating you, I'm celebrating with you, I'm celebrating my son, our community, and the people outside of this community who are finally paying attention. We're gonna get there. We're gonna get there together. Happy Juneteenth, everybody.
Hi there, Grio family. For those of you who are just joining us, I'm Christina Grio, the politics editor at TheGrio, and with me today are Mark Lamont Hill and Dana Blair. That was quite inspiring. I'm so excited for this. I'm beyond excited. So for the next few minutes, I want us to talk about Black history. I want to talk about Jim Crow segregation, how we continue to trod this stony road as Black people in America. what Senator Harris said about, you know, the Committee for Justice and Policing Act that she has going on with Senator Cory Booker reminded me of this idea that protest politics for Black people is so necessary for policy changes on the electoral space. I mean, it's a both and for us so many times that we can't just rely on one or the other. We have to take our passion and all the movements that we build in the streets with all the activists and organizers who work tirelessly to change policy in the halls of our state houses in Washington, D.C., and in city halls in our cities and towns across the country. We have to remember that Ahmaud Arbery died and was murdered actually months before most Americans ever knew his name. And it's because of the tireless work of activists and organizers who kept his memory alive for us to know today. I do want to just, Dana and Mark, sort of, I'll see how you all feel about this when we have our larger conversation, but I have chosen not to use the word slave. I use the word enslaved African or enslaved human. For me, slave is a noun, and it takes away some of the brutality of U.S. chattel slavery that we experienced in this nation, across the globe, obviously, but it's talking about U.S. chattel slavery specifically. Yeah. And the reason why I use enslaved African or enslaved human beings because it makes it a relationship between two people. It makes it, the enslaver had to do something, he or she and their families. And it also puts agency on the enslaved human being, a person who had hopes and dreams and a family of their own, and recognizes their experience as a Black person on the soil. So I just wanted to sort of, as we think about the language we use in the next hour and a half, for those of you who are watching at home, I really was moved by Jemele Hill and Kelly Rowland being honest about the fact that they didn't initially celebrate Juneteenth. Many people who are tuning in today, this may be your very first Juneteenth that you're celebrating, whether you're Black American or not. And I think that that's okay. We also have to ask ourselves why it is that our American educational system has denied us. Black history is American history, and we deserve to know everything that creates our collective experience. We should demand to know more about all of our brothers and sisters who are on this land. So Mark, let me kick it off to you. Based on what you just heard from
this
beautiful dance movement, first things first, and then from Senator Harris, your girl Jemele Hill and Kelly Rowland.
Everybody, you know, Kelly Rowland, whenever I get any of the three parts of Destiny's Child on the screen, I'm excited because they mean so much to us. And that's part of the joy, you know, and Jemele Hill talked about, you know, sort of the journey into this moment and in terms of learning it. And that makes me excited as well, you know, because it's an educational process. We all had to come into a moment where we learned it. And you know, and what Kamala Harris is talking about is trying to take the next step, as she understands it, through action, through policy, through organizing, through resistance. And sometimes that resistance, as you said, is in the electoral space. Sometimes it's on the ground. Sometimes in history, it was on the plantation. And I think recognizing that whole story of Blackness is really, really, really important. Your point about, you know, enslaved Africans versus slaves is so key, because if you say slaves were brought here, it's easy to, you know, that's what slaves do. Right. And that's what slaves do. Right. But if we say, no, these were people, right, whose history was interrupted and lives were stolen and they were enslaved. Now it's a whole different conversation. And that's the conversation that's been missing from school. That's the reason why we haven't talked about Juneteenth much. It's because we haven't had an honest conversation that Black people built America, and that the American South doesn't exist without the labor of Black folk. The accompanying industries of the North don't exist without Black American labor, and that labor was stolen, because then you end up to a slippery slope down to reparations. You end up having a very different conversation. And two quick things. One is, you know, if we're going to talk about this journey from 1619 until now, it's a story of Black resistance at all times, whether it was people throwing off ships, whether it was somebody jumping off the ship, whether it was somebody slowing down the work on the plantation, whether it was somebody running away, whether it was somebody helping somebody else run away, whether it was fighting to vote, fighting to read, fighting to pray, you know, fighting to eat, fighting to use a bathroom, fighting to use a water fountain. We've resisted at every turn, and we've had white allies from the beginning, but it's Black folks' agencies, Black folks' efforts that have gotten us free. So to me, that is the beauty of all of this. And don't think you slick, Dr. Greer. I saw, she said the road we've trod, the story. You slipped in a extra verse. You slipped in the second verse of the Black national anthem. That's some high level black stuff right there. Most people don't know the second verse. That's bars right there. I respect that.
That's right. We are celebrating, because the thing is, and you know, you and Dana said this in our first segment, and for those of you who are just joining us, I'm Christina Greer, politics editor at The Grio. I'm here with Mark Lamont Hill, proprietor of Uncle Bobby's in Philadelphia. Please support your local Black-owned bookstore. And Dana Blair, princess of Louisiana, but just an extraordinary activist and community leader in her own right. But I mean, I think what we have to also remember in those struggles that you just mentioned, Mark, there has always been joy. Black people have always been able to find a moment, whether it's looking at the wings of a butterfly or a soft touch on the back of a hand so that the master doesn't see it. We have been able to figure out a way, whether it's dressing up in our Sunday best. Our colleague Tanisha Ford has written about sort of dressing in dreams and how Black people have fashion as a resistance tool, right? Ooh. If we think about how we've used philanthropy in our own special ways, well before we had Oprah Winfrey, we had folks who were able to funnel money. You know, we had Coretta Scott King, not just doing fish fries and chicken fries, she was playing the piano to raise money for the civil rights movement. And we've always used our talent, right, to bring about change. And whether that talent is subtle or something extreme, we've been able to change the course of history, not just American history. We've literally, and we'll talk about this later on when we see some of the artists who have joined us, but we've literally changed the landscape of the world. So, I mean, Dana, as someone who is in the artist community, I mean, how are you feeling about how you can take the culmination of our history and we have this joy, this perseverance? It's a complicated melange of who we are as human beings in this country.
It's also a part of our spirit. We saw the Muntu Dance Theater, the drums, the percussions, the rhythm. It's a part of who we are. It's within us, and it's a source of joy. It's a source of release. It's a source of your creativity is the one thing that cannot be harnessed externally, right? In a time when you're often when you feel suppressed by in the civil rights movement with Black codes, and when you are physically and mentally and emotionally being oppressed in slavery, it's your creativity, that joy, those moments in your home, those moments in your heart, those moments of expression are the one thing that you can't limit. And that's powerful. And through that, we're able to share our voice, we're able to share our pain, we're able to share our joy, everything, tell our stories, and that lives on forever.
Mm-hmm. I think that this, Jamel mentioned this collective trauma that we've all experienced and we are experiencing is really something that we have to keep in the forefront of our minds, but wrapping that in the joy is of the utmost importance. So Mark, I'll kick it off to you.
You know, it is pretty cool what we got here. We have, you know, we already had like a Destiny's Child member. Now we got a legend who's Destiny's Child adjacent, right? We got Tina Knowles Lawson. We have Stacey Abrams. We have Amanda Seales, who's hosting this year's BET Awards, plug for BET. We got Kendrick Sampson. We got Jack Ross. We have just so many amazing people right now who are going to offer some words, inspire us, and just lead us down the way.
Hi. You know, Juneteenth is our holiday. I grew up in Galveston, Texas. And, you know, in 1865 was when we found out that the slaves were free. Everybody else in other parts of the country had been free for 2 to 3 years. But that's when Galveston, Texas found out, and this general brought thousands of troops there to announce it. And so, obviously, it was a big celebration day. And when I was growing up, we all went to the beach because it's an island. And we all barbecued and had our family and friends over and celebrated, you know, Juneteenth, as we call it. We had parades, and it was a big deal. In fact, more Black people celebrated Juneteenth than they did 4th of July. And when I moved to California, I was in shock because I said, oh, I want to have a Juneteenth party, not a 4th of July. And my friends were like, what is that? So I know that everyone doesn't know the history of it, but it's a very significant day. It's called Juneteenth. So let's start celebrating it. The 4th of July was not our Emancipation Day, but you know, not of all of us anyway. So let's adopt that one and have these June 19th celebrations.
I am delighted to join you in commemorating Juneteenth, a day for remembering the promise of freedom for African Americans. The story of Black emancipation in this country is one of strength, perseverance, and fortitude. Ours is a tale of combating discrimination and disenfranchisement to push America to live up to its highest ideals. In the midst of our struggle, we have found joy, and we have pushed through a numbing grief to lift up our storied past and focus on a brighter future. In America today, we are witnessing a new generation of leaders rising up and carrying on the tradition of activists such as Ida B. Wells, Bayard Rustin, Fannie Lou Hamer, and John Lewis. They protest to bring attention to the wrenching pain of systemic injustice that has left far too many African Americans in a state of anguish and despair for generations. But they also plan for tomorrow, as should we. We must demand health care in a time when COVID-19 has disproportionately killed Black people. We must harness ambition during an economic crisis that has endangered the livelihoods of working families, many of whom were already struggling to make ends meet. And we must be fueled by outrage in a nation where Black people have been killed with impunity. In 2020, we have the opportunity to transform America, to elect leaders at every level of government who see us, who hear us, and who are willing to act on our demands and their responsibilities. We have the obligation to complete the 2020 census and ensure that we receive the financial resources and political representation that our communities are entitled to hold. I know that at this moment, voting and filling out the census can feel trivial and inadequate, but I know that these actions bring us closer to equity and equality. Voting and completing the census are the first steps on a long and vital process, tedious but necessary. And while these actions will not save us from harm, silence will surely damn us all. On this Juneteenth, remember our power and our purpose. For centuries, we have fought for a fairer America and transformed this nation in order to form a more perfect union. And we have the ability to transform the future once again. Our time is now. Together, let us lift our voices to create the future we deserve.
Juneteenth is a day that should have been heralded as a national holiday for long before I was ever in school pledging a flag, before we were ever in school singing a Star Spangled Banner. It's a day that should have been taught to us in the context of all the reasons that were wrong with it and all the reasons that were right with it. And when I say that, it's because there's a lot of talk about Juneteenth right now, you know, with corporations, et cetera, and wanting to have a Juneteenth celebration because of Black people. But I think what we have to remember with Juneteenth is that Juneteenth is very representative of what's going on now. Juneteenth was the result of surreptitiousness, of duplicitousness, of nefariousness. Three big words that all mean of shadiness going on at the expenses of human beings. You see, Juneteenth was all about the real day that slavery actually ended, because it was when the states that were pretending to not know what was going on with the Emancipation Proclamation finally conceded and acquiesced to its realities, which were that the states would remain united, and under that, slavery would be abolished. There were so many folks that were still enslaved simply because their masters did not feel that they needed to adhere to the law of the land. They didn't feel like they needed to pay attention to that because these human beings didn't matter. And when we look at the eruption of consciousness going on right now, what we see is a whole bunch of people who didn't think they needed to pay attention to how human beings were being treated. They didn't think they needed to concern themselves with the actual laws of the land because it didn't matter to them. Well, it does matter, and it did matter. And we matter. Black lives matter.
not just in response to the police, but Black lives and our histories and our present and our futures matter. And when we celebrate Juneteenth, we are celebrating that these lives that were disrespected and disregarded, they mattered. And it matters that we continue to move forth in making sure that their lives were not in vain. Happy Juneteenth. This is our Independence Day.
Juneteenth is my favorite holiday. I'm from H-Town, born in H-Town, grew up in Mo City, right outside. And down the street was Galveston, Texas. That's the island where the last slaves found out they were freed almost 3 years after the Emancipation Proclamation was signed. And we know it wasn't about the person who signed the Emancipation Proclamation, right? No freedom was ever given to us. No oppressor ever woke up and said, you know what, y'all are right. It was fought for. We fought and we won. When we fight, we win. That was hardcore abolitionists and radical freedom fighters that were risking it all to make sure that everybody was free. They weren't just satisfied with most being free. They said, we need to make sure everybody is free, not until the last person, because if one of us is in bondage, all of us are in bondage. That's abolition. Uproot, burn the roots, and build new. You know, that's the lesson that I think we need to take from Juneteenth is to make sure that we fight until all of us are free, that all Black lives matter, right? And that we dismantle all these forms of oppression, of transphobia, white supremacy, capitalism, dismantle and abolish all of these systems, the prison system, the policing system that is the continuation of the legacy of slave catching, direct lineage of that, defund the police. Take all that money and all those resources that have been stolen and extracted from our community, invest them in care and wellness of our community. And healing. This is a day to mourn, grieve, celebrate, experience joy in community with each other, because we know that the fight isn't over, but we can heal together in community, and that's what's most important about Juneteenth. Let's do that shit together and not be distracted by all these companies that are finally acknowledging as a company holiday. It should be a national holiday. See, we grew up in Houston, in Texas, knowing that Independence Day was a bullshit holiday. Our people, our ancestors weren't free. We celebrate Juneteenth to celebrate the last slaves that finally found out that they were free, because that is what we need to continue to strive for, making sure everybody is free. Collective liberation. That's why it's my favorite holiday. Also because the food is banging. Food is off the chain. You know, in Houston, we got Creole food, we got barbecue and smoked meats and collard greens and sweet potatoes and cornbread and all that shit. I mean, that's my favorite holiday, dancing and grooving. Joy is part of the resistance.
Now I know that I done wrong, but I'm gonna keep trying. May I lost so many times before, but I'm gonna keep fighting. Everybody's gonna fall sometimes, I won't stay down long. When that light shines down on my face, I'll rise from the ground. Lord knows I prayed my heart would be too strong to break. Oh, so I could just take.
Welcome back, Grio family. I'm Christina Greer. Joining me now are Mark Lamont Hill and Dana Blair. What we just saw was the thoughtfulness of Tina Knowles Lawson, the brilliance of Stacey Abrams, the directness of Amanda Seales and Kendrick Sampson, and the incredible talent of Jack Rosen. So without further ado, I just want to get to some of the performances we have from our very own HBCUs that we
watched. Yeah.
Yes, we got it, Morehouse. But it's also Black Music Month. And so we're highlighting some amazing artists on thegrio.com. So be sure to check that out. So without further ado, HBCU Marching Band.
Roll another one.
Sit up, never like you know it's supposed to pack it with the automatics. We gon' set them to have it. Wait.
Hey. Woo.
Huh?
Are you feeling sturdy?
Feeling sturdy. Shake it, shake it. She like the way that I dance. She like the way that I move. She like the way that I rock. She like the way that I woo. And she let it clap for it.
She let it clap for it.
And she throw it back for it.
Yeah, she throw it back for it.
Michael Mary. Billie Jean. Christian Dior. Come up in all the stores. When it rains, it pours. She like the way I heard.
Wanna get me hot, he just tryna get my he wanna taste of my goodies, he say it tastes like butterscotch. No, you cannot get me locked, you tryna get me, you get black. Unless you tryna marry me, my ring must be big as a rock. I open up my candy shop, my panties drop, you see what I got. I got the strawberries and berries, dark chocolate slice, all in a box. No, you better stop, cause I am the cream of the crop. Baby, you know what I got. I'm top notch.
Walking public till your body started to ignite. When you push up on it, put that thing on me, boy. What's poppin', baby? Can you put me to sleep, yeah? Every time you see me, do me dirty. Yeah. I eat bad, I talk that, I want that, you babe. I can't wait till midnight. Baby, come see me.
Yeah, we nucky and bucky and ready to fight. How better I'ma throw them
It's all you, Mark.
Oh, man. It's on me. I was so into the music, to tell you the truth. I was really appreciating it. What did y'all think about the performances?
Oh, I was jamming the whole time. I was like, yes. I learned some new moves. I was like, I might pull a hamstring, but I'm definitely going to try it once we go back outside.
Nobody does it quite like black marching bands, you know what I mean, HBCU bands especially. Like we just have a different thing to it. It's in our DNA to love that, and I love that. It also reminds me of how much joy is in the performance and how much joy is in black struggle. You know, as we've been saying the whole night, you can't have black struggle without black joy. You know, whether it's singing, whether it's dancing, whether it's the way we write, whether it's joking, because we got jokes. You could be in misery and have jokes. You know what I mean? I spent time with people on death row, and some of the jokes brothers have. You would think you were at like, you know, like a comedy club, and not that they don't take the situation serious, but it's like we understand that joy, that laughter and smiling and dancing and loving each other is part of our resistance.
Right. And shout out to Senator Harris, who's a proud Bison, and shout out to Stacey Abrams, who's a proud Spelman alum. So.
Oh, very, very, very true. And the HBCUs, it's producing, they produce the best of so much, you know, and this just proves it, whether it's Stacey Abrams or Kamala Harris, or the great Thurgood Marshall, or whoever, or the huge number of people who come out of HBCUs. But we don't just produce brilliant people, we also change the world. And that's what I find so much pride in.
Absolutely. It's unfortunate that often HBCUs are overlooked in the conversation when it comes to education, though.
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
So we are going to keep this energy going. Our next set of videos are from a group of individuals I'm sure most of you out there, Grio.com family, are familiar with, expressing their feelings and sentiments, and they're frustrated, and rightfully so. We have actor Sterling K. Brown, U.S. Representative Hank Johnson, Lodrick Collins, actor Lodrick Collins, poet Anastasia Renee, and actor William Jackson Harper.
June 19th, 1865 is the day that we celebrate the last of slaves in this country, knowing that it was no longer legal for them to be enslaved. It was the day that we all knew that we were free. Every 4th of July, people say Happy Independence Day or whatnot. And I always just say, yeah, you know, Happy 4th of July. I like to pop off some fireworks and, you know, have some libation with friends and family, but it's not a celebration of freedom. Juneteenth is a celebration of our freedom. And we're celebrating it, and we're still fighting for it. We have it in name, and we look to have it in actuality, in practice. Equality is freedom. The right to live just as anyone else is freedom. So much going on in the world right now. All of the deaths that we have seen recently of black and brown people at the hands of law enforcement or people taking law into their own hands. I'm ready for real freedom. I'm ready for real equality. And I'm ready for it now. Happy Juneteenth.
Juneteenth marks the end of slavery in this nation. Since June 19, 1865, African Americans in the entire country have made monumental strides in equality for all. We've outlawed segregation, integrated segregated schools, and afforded the right to vote to every American. Though we've fought through Jim Crow laws, voter suppression, an oppressive and unfair justice system, along with a history of systemic racism, the reality is that education, housing, and health care remain inadequate for far too many African Americans. Racism is still endemic in American society, and though we've made monumental strides, much remains to be done. We're told to get over it and to just move on, to stop dwelling on the past, and that racism no longer exists. But we're having flashbacks after watching the videotaped killings of George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, Rayshard Brooks, and others. These videos show today's America, but they also take us back to a time when law enforcement and vigilante groups like the KKK hunted down and killed black people with impunity. We're seeing in real time why we should not, and we will not, take our progress for granted. This is our reality, but as we've done throughout our history, we will remain strong and we will continue the fight for equality. And I'm encouraged as I see our white, our Latinx, and our Asian brothers and sisters coming to the forefront to help in this fight to redeem the soul of America. So while some Americans will remember this Juneteenth as the year Nike and Twitter made Juneteenth an official holiday, I myself will think back to the trip I took with my brother, Congressman John Lewis, and several of my CBC colleagues. We went to Ghana, where we visited the Cape Coast, and the door of no return to pay tribute to the millions of lives lost in the transatlantic slave trade. We're all reminded that this year's Juneteenth celebration doesn't just mean we remember where we came from, but it's a reminder that we must never let history repeat itself. This Juneteenth serves as a recommitment to the quest to build a more righteous and just America with liberty and equality and justice for all. Thank you.
Hey, it's Lodrick D. Collins here. Listen, to me, Juneteenth represents an understanding that oppression is not patriotic, now it's not Christian, and it's definitely not progressive. Yet still, we are under this repetition currently of the same mistake where, 250,000 black people during this time were acknowledged of their freedom. But today, over 2 million black people represent the population of those currently under mass incarceration. It's still unwilling, God-created human beings whose bodies are used to boost our economy. It doesn't sound patriotic. It doesn't sound Christian, and it definitely does not sound progressive. So, I believe that Juneteenth is a symbol reminding us to stay woke.
In case you forgot, I am not your Negro, James Baldwin. America, I am not interested in being your little fish, your pond, your net, your wade in the water. I am not interested in your bait or the way you casually breach my gutted future upon your mother's soured land. I am not your Negro.
Juneteenth is a huge holiday for me because it is the real celebration of freedom for enslaved people from my home state of Texas. And, I think it marks the end of one of the most draconian measures of white supremacy in this country. And I think it's just a sign that we've come a long way. It took a long time to get there, and we still have a long way to go. But I think that it's important to mark this day so we don't forget, and that we sort of keep ourselves honest and keep trying to move forward.
Hi, Grio family. I'm Christina Greer, and joining me this evening are Mark Lamont Hill and Dana Blair. We have an action-packed evening filled with activists and poets and artists and politicians and actors who are helping us contextualize what Juneteenth means to us. There's been a collective understanding and reckoning that's been happening in this country based on the recent killings of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and most recently, Rashad Brooks. There have been protests, there have been uprisings, and it seems as though we're entering into a new phase of a new civil rights movement, possibly a new revolution in this country. Many people are very prepared for that intellectually, emotionally, spiritually, and patriotically as well. So Dana, before you introduce our next set of guests, Mark, what are sort of some of your feelings right now as you reflect on what's been said, and as you start moving forward in these past, say, 2 months that we've had?
Yeah, you know, we have the backdrop of COVID and so much death and so much misery and so much of a sense of being unsafe and unprotected, susceptible to premature death. And there's a way that America felt like that. And there's a way that America suddenly understood that that's kind of the Black experience forever. But even in the midst of that, as Stacey Abrams said, there's a way that Black folk got the brunt of that too. And so there's so much misery. And then while that's happening, we see all these examples of people getting killed, Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, multiple trans women were killed or simply beaten or attacked. We just saw Rashad Brooks killed 2 weeks ago or the Friday before last in the Wendy's parking lot. So much death, so much resistance to that death. And for me, I'm not sure that the world could have been paying attention if not for COVID, right? Because we're all, there's no games on, there's no work to do, people aren't outside, it's warm, we're focused. My point is, even in a moment of misery, Dr. King said, even only when it's darkest can you see the stars. There's a way that we've been in the darkest moment possible for the last few months. But the star is this beautiful resistance around the country. The star is the renewed attention. The star is the fact that even when Donald Trump tries to co-opt Juneteenth, either by accident or to or on racist purpose, we now have a whole country of people talking about Juneteenth for the first time. So I am actually, as sad as I am about the death and as worn out as I am from seeing our death, I'm also inspired that we all see that star and we're all moving toward it. And that has me excited.
Agreed. And thank you so much for sharing. Dana, lead us out.
Absolutely. I just want to kind of echo Mark's sentiments as well as reach back to something that Kendrick said in terms of, you know, uprooting the tree, exposing the root. We have to look at the root of the problem. Where did all of this come from? Acknowledge it. And I think that, as Mark said, you know, it's unfortunate that these men and women of our community, as well as our brothers and sisters in the trans community, had to die for the world to start to pay attention. But there's something magical about what's happening right now. It feels different than before, which I find extremely inspirational and hopeful. And I love the movement that I'm seeing across social media, keeping the names of these men and women and members of our trans community on the tips of everyone's tongues, in front of their faces, and demanding justice. And I find that extremely inspirational. For those of you who are just joining us and out there in the Grio family watching, please make sure you head over to thegrio.com each and every day, multiple times a day, for more updates and information on these stories. Next up, we have another powerful group of videos and contributors joining us. We have poet and activist Crystal Valentine, recording artist, one of my personal favorites, Anthony Hamilton, choreographer Michael Bishop, and actress Deborah Joy Winans.
Victory. So you think you just gonna kill me with my family watching, with the street lights making a mockery out of safety. You think you can just wrap my body in soil and call it a funeral, call it a blackout, call it a victory? You think you won? Don't you know us black folk make a habit out of resurrection? Don't you know we make a habit out of coming back and collecting what's ours? You think our bodies don't know how to rise? That we're not magic? That we won't win? You have a gun, and all I got are these fists and this spit, and this faith that one day black will once again lick itself around the earth. All I have are these hands meant for carrying my kin, and this mouth that'll battle cry its way up to heaven, and this revolution spit shining my spine. But you have a gun. You have a bullet waiting for my mother, and a chokehold waiting for my brother, and a camera waiting to make us all famous and guilty at the same time. And isn't that beautiful? An army full of mothers that are only as famous as our son's death. You think you won't win? You think a bullet can separate the glory from our skin? You got a gun, but I got a mouth meant for swallowing the things that are trying to kill me. I got a stomach of titanium, bones radiating with 1980 riots. I got a body full of things that don't know how to die.
Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom, the end of slavery, 1865, the emancipation of black.
For too long our skin has been seen as sin, washed away by men who grin, joyous in their destruction of kin. But today we stand to defend. We fight for justice. We fight for peace. We fight for the rights of those deceased. We fight for the incarcerated, may they be set free, found innocent of crimes in the face of your greed. We fight for all, including LGBT, and all other letters that coincide with we. And if you dare to stand against thee, it is you who will stand on the wrong side of history. So rise up, my kings and queens, it's time to sound off. All our allies hit the ground, it's time to pound off. Don't let their hatred penetrate it, link together and round off. And like an earthquake, just vibrate it and remember to start soft. Now pick up speed and say it louder, scream from the mountains and say it prouder. Black lives matter in the face of racism and watch it shatter. Sound off.
These are Black lives, and
we
matter.
What's up, y'all? It's Deborah Joy Winans. Juneteenth is a very important day in our history. It is our emancipation. More than that, it is what our ancestors fought and died for. It is what our fellow brothers and sisters are fighting and dying for even now in 2020. And so it is important to recognize where we come from. It is important to know how far we've come, and it is important to know how far we still have to go. But it is also important to celebrate that victory. We are a beautiful, wonderful people. I've never been so proud to be a Black woman. And so, y'all, happy Juneteenth.
I'm Christina Greer, and with me are Mark Lamont Hill and Dana Blair. I couldn't agree with Deborah Joy Winans more. I have never been happier to be a Black woman at this moment. Dana, so we have some comments from our Facebook Live, and Crystal Valentine said, "We make a habit out of resurrection." What do you think?
It reminds me of a phrase that we have in my family that says, whenever I'm feeling down, my father says, remember what you're made of may bend, but it does not break. And making a habit out of resurrection, not you can't break us, our spirit. No matter what you try to put on us, we will rise to the occasion, surpass the bar, and we will innovate, and we will continue to push and recreate and be the leaders of all things that are cool and be creative. I loved actually even the fact that that social media went into a tizzy this week. We found out that Beethoven was a brother, you know, like we're always just discovering new ways to shine, you know, in spite of what others try to do to us. So that's what that means to me.
And Mark, we got 30 seconds. Tell me about your resurrection.
Oh man, that's I'm just warming up when I get that. I'm inspired by our fight, you know. We're facing COVID and we found joy. We created a whole new world of DJing on Instagram, right? We created verses, you know, and watched our favorite artists, you know, go. I'm just thinking about the artistic realm, how we crafted joy when they thought they killed us. White supremacy wants us dead and we refuse to die. And that for me is the resurrection. That's the joy that we keep coming back and nothing can stop us.
Well, thank you. So right now we're going to hear from actresses Lorraine Toussaint and Tina Lifford, author Adrian Miller, and recording artist Elijah Blake. Take a listen.
Juneteenth is a day of remembrance. That's how I'm celebrating it. I can't imagine what those slaves must have felt like waiting those 2.5 years while Texas refused to recognize the Emancipation Proclamation until their freedom was actually taken by force. You know, it's a day of remembering that oftentimes freedom just ain't free. And so I'm gonna pray and remember, and I don't know, hope. There's hope on the horizon. This is a wonderful moment. It's a great opportunity. There's a window here for us to step into where we claim our freedom yet again. So that's what Juneteenth is about for me this year.
This Juneteenth, as one of the most targeted and attacked communities on the planet, let's celebrate all that we have managed to accomplish to upset ideas of racial supremacy that date back since before Christ, back to the ancient Greeks 3,000 years ago. Since this day in 1865, that's 155 years ago, we have found our voice. We have grown in numbers. We have global allies. Our dollars are powerful. Our resilience, creativity, and hearts undeniable. We are formidable. We are the fly in the ointment. Change takes what it takes. So let's celebrate the resilience of our ancestors. Let's celebrate our resilience. And let's keep our eyes on the prize of the future of our children's children and their children. Let's vote, let's get right with God, and let's fill our hearts with hope and purpose. Happy Juneteenth.
Hi, I'm Adrian Miller, the soul food scholar who's dropping knowledge like hot biscuits. I'm the author of a James Beard award-winning book on the history of soul food called Soul Food, The Surprising Story of an American Cuisine, One Plate at a Time. Soul food is the coming together of three different parts of the world in terms of the ingredients, culinary techniques, and traditions. So you've got Western Africa meets Western Europe in the Americas. The typical soul food meal is something like this. The entrees could be fried chicken, either or smothered chicken, could be smothered or fried pork chops, could be some kind of fried fish. Catfish is usually popular, but you've got whiting and other types of fish. Another option is chitlins. That's pig intestines, which are either stewed or fried, not for everyone. And then side dishes, you usually have greens, and greens in the soul food culture, in terms of ones that are most popular, would be collards, kale, mustard, turnip, and cabbage. So if you've discovered kale in the last, say, 5 to 10 years, welcome to the party. We've been eating it for about 300. Then some kind of bean is popular. So black-eyed peas, even though they're called peas, they're actually a bean. But black beans and pinto beans are popular in soul food. Another option is to have candied sweet potatoes or candy jams, dark fleshed orange sweet potato. And then you could have macaroni and cheese. That's popular, mac and cheese. Then there's going to be some kind of cornbread involved, or there could be wheat bread, but cornbreads, I think, are more emblematic of soul food. Then a bottle of hot sauce, because we like to put hot sauce on everything. And then some kind of red drink, because I believe that red Kool-Aid is the official soul food drink. Now, you have to understand, in soul food culture, red is a color and a flavor. So we don't get caught up in calling things cherry or strawberry or tropical punch or that it has hints of cranberry. It's just red. Now, there is a generational shift happening. There are a lot of youngins that seem to like purple and blue. And as I wrote in my book on soul food, I do believe the children are our future, that we should teach them well and let them lead the way, but not on Kool-Aid because they're messing it up. And then for dessert, you could have something like pound cake, peach cobbler, banana pudding, or sweet potato pie. So those are examples of types of soul food. So soul food really takes root during slavery in the antebellum period in the British colonies in North America, which would become the United States. So enslaved people pretty much ate seasonal vegetables with water during the week. But then on the weekends, they had more access to things like white flour and white sugar. Could barbecue, could fry fish and other things. So some of the things that we think about in terms of soul food are really the celebration food of the antebellum South. And that's the food that black migrants take with them outside the South and transplant in other parts of the country. So when you think of other immigrant cultures, what happens is they leave one place, they come to another, and they try to recreate home. And if they can do it with the foods that they had back home, they do so. But if not, they often have to find substitutes. They're looking at what their new neighbors are doing, experimenting, incorporating that in their cuisine. I argue that soul food is really the migrant cuisine of all those African Americans who left the South during what was called the Great Migration. Because if you're in the South, first of all, soul food is not that popular of a term. I mean, they're as quick to call it country cooking or home cooking. And then the differences between Southern and soul are not as pronounced as they are outside of the South. When I'm asked what is the difference between Southern and soul, I would say that it's really how the cuisine is performed. It is a matter of soul food being spicier, more seasoned, reliance on variety meats, and usually the lines between savory and sweet are blurred. So, example, you could have sugar in your cornbread. That's another hallmark of soul food. So this cuisine is a truly American fusion cuisine. It's something that African Americans excelled at. They were also heavily influenced Southern cooking. And these cooks actually were the foundation for much of American food. And I hope that we can learn more about their contributions to American cuisine and honor them. Thank you.
What's going on, everybody? It's your boy, Elijah Blake. Shout out to my incredible friends and family over at TheGrio. We are here together to celebrate an incredible time. Juneteenth is on the horizon. And I would love to share with you guys a poem that's dear to my heart. It's called The Lineage. Black History Month, 7% of the year is set aside for 14% of the nation. When you position equality against economy, the majority will speak. And that green will forever be bigger than my black. They assign teams, and there will forever be nigga on my back. Can you please teach me less about Rome and Pompeii? See, that's the irony of the conversation with Mr. Belafonte. You're black born, so your platform must be used to stop the wrongs because you can cage the singer, but not the song. Happy Juneteenth, everybody. Much love. Elijah Blake.
Welcome back, Grio family. I'm Christina Greer. Here with me is Mark Lamont Hill and Dana Blair. I hope you all have enjoyed the show. As we begin to wrap up, I just want to let you know, first of all, I'm hungry. And I feel, not only am I hungry because of Adrian Miller explaining all of the cuisine that we've grown to love and enjoy, but I'm also simultaneously feeling full. Lorraine Toussaint talked about hope. We had our elected officials give us the importance of transitioning from protest politics to electoral politics and the importance of both of those. I mean, I want to move my body. I've seen HBCU marching bands and Mr. Bishop, Michael Bishop, and the wonderful dancers that he presented this evening in there. I mean, I'm just so inspired. It's like people are dancing in their kitchens, in their backyards. Yes. It's like, can't stop, won't stop. I mean, there is nothing that can keep Black people down. It is impossible. So Dana, tell me some of the highlights for you this evening. Just, this has exceeded my expectations. And I also want to just say, I'm filled with gratitude. I have never spent a Juneteenth this way. And I'm so thankful that I'm spending my first Juneteenth like this with you all, not just with you, Mark and Dana, but with everyone else out there at thegrio.com, our Grio family. So Dana, what are you feeling?
I'm a little biased. I come from the theater and dance world. So of course I love all of the dancing. I love all of the music. But yes, there is something different about this Juneteenth. I love the words of inspiration. I'm feeling, as you mentioned, I'm feeling full. I'm feeling recharged, echoing Mark's sentiment, finding that joy and that light in the darkness is recharging my spirit, because now I'm ready to go back into the world and continue to do what we need to do. And just hearing all of those words of inspiration and encouragement, I'm feeling hopeful. And so this has been a great experience for me as well.
Yeah. Mark, how are you feeling?
First of all, I'm feeling hungry too. He said Black folk, we call our drink red. We put hot sauce on everything. You know, I'm sitting here in my office ready to go, you know? So I felt very seen. But that's the great thing about doing this thing with y'all, you know, is that, you know, we share tradition, we share culture, we share love. So when we hear that marching band, you know, our spirits had the same reaction to it. You know, when we hear those poems, you know, they speak to our bones in a certain kind of way. And when I see so many people talking about coming into consciousness, I get especially excited. It's one thing for people who've been doing Juneteenth their whole life to continue to do it. And that's a beautiful thing. We need our traditions. But there's something especially beautiful also about a new generation of folk coming in and doing our traditions and adding to the tradition and building on the tradition. And that's how we survive, because another generation comes and picks up the baton for us. And our ancestors handed it to us, and it's our job to expand that work and keep it going. So, you know, my joy tonight has been just watching all the people committed to learning and to growing. And again, this conversation about food got me hungry. So we're gonna watch some more videos.
I'll send you a plate, Mark. I'll send you a plate.
I need it. I need collard greens and no kale. I mean, I love kale, but I need some collard greens. I need some fried chicken. I need all that stuff. And if you missed, by the way, if you missed what we've been doing tonight, or you only caught part of it, you can watch it again. And if you saw the whole thing and just want to see it again, you can watch it on thegrio.com. You can watch the whole stream one more time. But we got some people that's left over that still want to talk to us. Some people who got some things to say. So let's give it up to Imani Cezanne, the poet. Senator Kevin Parker, a Democrat out of New York. Lovie Simone, the brilliant actress. And of course, Infinity's Song, the music band, is going to play us out. We got so much dope stuff, so check this out.
I'm going to read a poem that I actually wrote around 2014, 2015, during the Ferguson uprisings, shortly after Mike Brown was killed. And it's not necessarily my favorite poem of mine, but I think it's my most honest. It's called Protest. My older brother is really good at being, well, older. He's a Belizean brown, the kind the girls write home about. His outfits go nowhere wrinkled. He likes his chicken and waffles on the same plate, but not on the same bite. He likes his bow ties to match his socks. He knows a bunch of random facts about volcano surfing and how fish have the ability to drown. But what I love most about my brother is that he always answers the phone. I called my brother today just because I could. Because he's still alive. And this was my protest. This was how I fought the man for the man I love the most. How I told the government about itself. This is how I overcame my fear of voicemail. How an unanswered ring becomes permission to panic. Where is he? Is he okay? Is he missing? Would we find him? Would there be a rope around his neck when we did? Would the flames leave nothing behind but bones that could belong to anyone? Would we speak of what he looked like with his hands up? Of how his name rolls off the tongue like a hashtag? Would you know his police record, but never his voice? I called my brother today. Just because I could. Because I'm still alive. And this was the most noise I could make. Yesterday, I marched in the street. The passersby were inconvenienced by the acknowledgement of the dead, and I wondered, where you got to be so quick you can't stop for a moment of silence? What have you done for 4.5 hours that was like watching no one come for your child's body? How civil a disobedience do you expect when black boys are buried and then put on trial? Yesterday, I held my fist in the air while the internet trolls asked, why break the windows, but not why kill the black kid. Yesterday, I was an activist. Yesterday, I was a radical. Yesterday, I was ready to set this country on fire, auction block by auction block. But today, I am just a little sister. Today, there is no more fight left in me. Meanwhile, the streets, they're gagging on the flesh of the slaughtered. They do not chew with their mouths closed. There is nothing well-mannered about a buffet of black bodies. No hero behind a gun fired to keep the safe more safe. The police, we do not need them. They fear for their lives without reason. But I know for a fact that they might kill my brother today. Just because he's black. Because he's still alive. And this is my most reasonable fear.
I'm State Senator Kevin Parker, and I represent the 21st District in Brooklyn. On June 19th, African Americans from across New York State should celebrate one of the oldest nationally celebrated commemorations of the ending of slavery in the United States. It's called Juneteenth. And unlike the 4th of July, this celebration commemorates the freedom of African Americans and the start of our education and future achievements. If you're unsure how to celebrate this holiday in these unprecedented times, you should try to have a small gathering with family and some friends while remembering to practice social distancing. Although not yet a national holiday, 46 of the 50 states observe Juneteenth as a recognized state holiday. Continue to fight to make this a national holiday. It's necessary for us to acknowledge our history. Remember, we are the people who were here the day before yesterday, and we're going to be the people who are going to be here the day after tomorrow.
Hi, everyone. It's Lovey Simone. I'm here with TheGrio, wishing you a happy Juneteenth. I celebrate Juneteenth because it is the oldest known celebration commemorating the ending of slavery. This was a huge stepping stone, but we are not done. And that is why I celebrate. I celebrate to hold myself accountable to my ancestors' dreams. And I also want to celebrate to bring awareness to that dream that they had. And I want to evolve spiritually and mentally and physically so that way it can ripple in my community. And I will continue to serve my community, and I will continue to buy from my community. And that will be what I will be doing on Juneteenth. So I hope you all do the same. I hope you all are being safe. I hope you all have a very blessed Juneteenth. And yes, yeah, so.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love.
there, Grio family. I'm Christina Greer. Joining me is Mark Lamont Hill and Dana Blair. We just want to thank you all so much for tuning in this past hour and a half of Black joy, Black beauty, Black brilliance, Black excellence, and Black love. I am feeling so grateful and thankful to be able to spend this Juneteenth with you all. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Dana. Do you all have any quick closing remarks for the folks out there? And please, for those of you who are watching, please come see us at thegrio.com, especially if you want to stream this episode.
I'm just happy we got to do this. I'm happy to spend it with y'all. And I look forward to many, many more of these.
Many more. God willing, the creek don't rise.
Exactly, right? I just want to say thank you so much to the Grio for putting on such an amazing celebration of Juneteenth. And thank you, Christina, and thank you, Mark. I needed this personally as well to refill my cup. So thank you very much.
Yes, thank you all so much. Thank you all for tuning in. Check us out on thegrio.com. Until then, be safe and happy Juneteenth. Bye.
Right.
We did it.
That was it. Good stuff, y'all. That was fun.
I don't know what happened on my IT, so I apologize, y'all.